Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you all for coming to this edition of Talks at GS. It's a great pleasure for me to welcome our three guests. William Wright, who's the founder and managing director of New Financial. Jim Esposito, who is co-head of the global financing group here at Goldman Sachs. And Philippe Ithurbide, global head of research strategy and analysis at Amundi. So, of course, it's very well known that Europe has been facing a whole set of economic, political, financial, and institutional challenges in recent years. Now, of course, we don't want to count our chickens too early in this respect, but I think on many of these dimensions, we are slowly seeing some progress being made. And certainly, if you look at our forecasts and the forecasts of most of our peers, there are signs, at least, of an economic recovery in Europe that's taking hold. So what that hopefully allows us to do is move away from some of the firefighting of dealing with the immediate crisis issues, which has been at the center of most of our work over the last few years, and try and think more about longer-term structural issues which support growth, support the development of the European economy and European governments over the longer term. And I think capital markets are, of course, central to that. They are central to the working of an economy, central to trying to improve economic performance. So let me turn then to the panel against that sort of background and maybe start with William, and then we'll work along the team. Why has this talk of what's been labelled a capital markets union emerged? And perhaps can you tell us initially what you see that as being?
Well, thank you, Huw. The main reason why we're now beginning to talk about capital markets union is that we're more than 20 years on from the official launch, the official creation of the single market in Europe. But we still have a patchwork of fragmented national capital markets. There's been a lot of progress over the past 20 years in terms of harmonizing capital markets across Europe. But we're still a very long way away from anything that you would call a single capital market. And I think there's a realization now at a policy level within Europe that we need to do something to break this vicious circle between low economic growth and the over-reliance of the European economy on bank lending, and moving towards greater use of capital markets, moving towards more harmonized capital markets, is perhaps an idea whose time has now come. I see capital markets union, and one of the problems with capital markets union is that if you ask 10 people what it means, you'll get at least 11 different answers right now. I see it first and foremost as simplifying and harmonizing, streamlining access to capital markets. Secondly, removing unnecessary artificial barriers to investment within capital markets. And thirdly, I think recalibrating, readjusting the regulatory environment in Europe for capital markets away from the sort of post-crisis urgency that we've seen over the past 5 or 6 years, to a new world where we're looking perhaps at not necessarily easing regulation, but re-regulating rather than necessarily deregulating, and certainly not piling on more regulation.
Jim, do you agree with that, or are you going to give us another definition?
I agree with all of that, although I'd add a market element to it. And what I would add is, make no mistake about it, right now we're living in very artificial capital market conditions. And I say that because the big three central banks, maybe a little bit less so now the Fed, but certainly the BOJ, and here in Europe, the ECB, are leaning in and propping up the banking system with accommodative funding and liquidity conditions and the broader capital markets. The one thing that we managed to avoid in Europe that I would have guessed we would have had coming out of the global financial crisis was some form of a major, if not a violent, round of deleveraging in the banking system. Now, policymakers, but specifically the ECB in this case, did a very good job in terms of their public policy initiatives by pumping liquidity into the capital markets and avoiding a banking system that was under an inordinate amount of pressure and being forced to delever at exactly the wrong time. You know, William mentioned, the big thing that goes on in Europe when you compare Europe to the US is the vast majority of credit extension of funding that gets provided to the real economy comes from the European banking system, We avoided a violent round of deleveraging, but we're living in these artificial conditions, and I wonder what happens when we get to the other side. And so what happens when the ECB is no longer there, propping up the banking system? I would argue the banking system's gonna need to shrink. The European banking system's not generating anywhere near their cost of equity right now. Most of them are generating, you know, 5 or 4% ROEs. Their cost of capital is 10 or 11%. That disconnect can't last forever. And so if you're concerned, like I am, about a European banking system that's gonna have to get a heck of a lot smaller in the years to come, you then have to be concerned about credit extension given it's a bank-dominated model. And so this discussion of capital markets union is really gonna be what needs to take the real economy in Europe, you know, to the next level, and it's not gonna be the banking system that does it. So the capital markets, if you want the economy to grow, is gonna have to step in to fill that void.
So I guess, I mean, you're emphasizing that capital markets have a role to play in terms of serving the economy, but also from the asset manager side, from the saver side. Philippe, perhaps you can tell us how you see capital markets.
I would say, as a consequence of what you say, William and Jim, what is important to have in mind is that for the very first time, the Europeans have put the emphasis on the small and mid-sized companies. This is very important because, as you know, to access to financing is very easy for a large corporate because they can issue a bond, stock, they have access to capital markets. And they want to kill the two birds with one stone. They want to favor the leveraging of the banks, and they want to have a more stable financial system. That means the banks having a lower burden on the financial, on the capital markets. But the question, of course, is why the SMEs? It's very simple, because SMEs represent the major part of the jobs. Just have in mind that for the past decade, 85% of net jobs were coming from the SMEs. Have in mind as well that the net creation, have in mind as well that innovation are coming from the startup SMEs, not from the big groups. Or even if we are big groups, we are innovative. But the bulk of innovation is coming from small to mid-sized companies. Have in mind as well that the small and mid-sized companies rely on the bank 95% around the Europe. So of course, the access to capital markets is crucial, and the very first time, the Europeans put the emphasis on this. And of course, as a consequence, if we want to favor long-term investment on real economy, we have to change some part of regulation. And this is one of the major consequences. Behind the capital markets union, there is a clear wish to alleviate regulation and to force savings to go into the real economy and to force, quote-unquote, the banks not to buy sovereign bonds, but to put the money on the real economy. This is probably the major challenge we have in front of us.
So perhaps, I mean, let me go back to Jim. I mean, we've talked a little bit about what changes may be required. I mean, all of you have one way or another sort of emphasized that banks may have played too big a role in the past. I mean, of course, European capital markets look different from American capital markets. So is it really just a question of making Europe more like America?
I think there'll be a big difference in the way credit gets extended going forward in Europe to the US, but with that said, I absolutely think there's things that we want to borrow from a US-style capital market system. The one thing that Europe's lacked when compared to the US over the past decade is a deep and sustainable pool of capital for below investment grade rated companies. And so when you look at sort of medium-sized companies in Europe, they've been too beholden to the banking system to finance their balance sheet. In the US, medium-sized companies have deep and liquid access to the high-yield bond market. And so for me, there's a lot to do around high-yield bonds in Europe. And I think the good news is the high-yield bond market has been growing by leaps and bounds. If you look over the last 6 or 7 years in Europe, high-yield bond volumes are up at about a 30% compound annual growth rate. So really healthy signs of growth. The investor base seems to be deeper and sort of willing to be more long-term holders of high-yield bonds. That to me is gonna be critical. And by the way, that will resemble the US style market going forward. Second thing I would just call out, again, more in the leverage finance space than the investment grade space, when you compare the two markets, the US to Europe, we don't have a deep and liquid institutional loan market in Europe. In the US, large size asset managers run big retail loan funds. Oftentimes, we're talking about a bank loan to bond trend playing out in Europe, and I don't think that's precise enough the way we say it. There's nothing wrong with loans. Loans are a great way for companies to finance their balance sheet. I'd like to see a deeper institutional loan market develop in Europe. Right now, the retail investor in Europe is precluded from investing in loans due to a bunch of different UCITS restrictions, whereas in the US, the loan product is open and available to the retail investor. So those are just examples of parts of the US capital markets I wouldn't mind learning from, borrowing, and ultimately transporting here to Europe. But there'll be other subtle, you know, differences and nuances as we play forward.
So William, I don't know if you'd agree with that, and perhaps, you know, do you have any ideas where Europe is doing things well and what some parts of the capital market might learn either from the US or from those areas where Europe is outperforming?
I think the first point from a policy perspective is that we have to be very careful about talking about copying or adopting a US model. Whatever solution we have from Capital Markets Union has to be made in Europe. And there are elements, as Jim rightly says, of US capital markets that we could very usefully adopt in Europe. Particularly, I think, this sweet spot of mid-market or the mid-market leveraged loan market and high-yield bond market. When you look at the depth of those markets, the capital markets in Europe, at that level, the sort of $250 million to $500 million deal size, and then compare it to the US, in the US it's five times deeper. So there is this massive over-reliance at that level of the market in Europe on bank financing, which, as Jim said earlier, is only going to become scarcer. But I think there are lots of areas in Europe where we perhaps beat ourselves up too much, particularly on the funds side. You look at something like the UCITS fund structure, it's an example of what can be achieved when different organizations, different countries come together and create a sort of portable pan-European standard and structure. And that's now been exported not just across the European Union, but outside of Europe as well. The IPO market, I think I'm right in saying that last year European companies raised more money through the IPO market than US companies.
Same is true in the first quarter of this year. Yeah.
So we often underestimate quite how much progress has been made over the past 25, 30 years in Europe. Mm-hmm.
And Philippe, I mean, from your perspective, I mean, as someone who would be buying these assets rather than producing and marketing them, I mean, what do you think needs to change in order to move us forward?
I think we have a lot of major changes to come. First of all, the capital markets do exist for large companies, large banks, very sophisticated asset managers. But the problem, again, is for the small and mid-sized companies, banks, asset managers, and corporates. But we need to develop new standards. You mentioned UCITS, but we need new standards on the bankruptcy laws, for example. We have a TLAC for the banks, but for the corporates, it's very vague at the moment. Second, we need to develop standards on the clearing settlement services. We need standards as well for the different markets, such as the high yield is done for the corporate bond market, but for the securitization, we need standardization, further standardization, and improve the quality of some products. For example, securitization is a fantastic product. 10 years ago, the banks were originating. Today, the asset managers are doing so. So the asset managers, in some way, are replacing some banks in some aspects of the service. And this is a new role for the asset managers. But we need to define what is the high-quality securitization.
It's an excellent point that we just have too many differences between different countries. If you look at the US, just an exchange clearing and settlement market infrastructure perspective, in the US there are two big exchange platforms competing with each other for listings, dozens of trading platforms competing for trading volumes, just talking equities here, which then feeds through into one clearing system and one settlement system. Let's cross over to this side of the Atlantic. We have 19 different stock exchange groups. That's groups. Within those 19 groups, there are more than 30 individual stock exchanges across Europe competing for listings, mainly on a national level. Those stock exchange groups then feed into 21 different clearing houses and I think 20 different settlement structures. We're putting enormous barriers, or we have inherited enormous barriers to the free flow of capital across borders in Europe from where it is to where it's needed. And anything that can be done in terms of pulling down those barriers has got to be a step forward.
My takeaway is there's in fact a lot of commonality across the three of you. What needs to be done? What are the potential benefits? So it does beg the question, why are we not making more progress? So one approach, I'm not sure this is what you're advocating, you can comment on that, a top-down approach. Another approach is to take more of a bottom-up initiative, more from the market participant side. So I don't know how you would each see, perhaps Jim, you could start on how you see the balance there, or what's necessary to overcome
this challenge. Yeah, I think one of the reasons why this conversation perhaps is frustrating and maybe we're not making progress at a pace that we need to get the European economy growing again is the elephant in the room. And for me, the elephant in the room is small and medium-sized enterprises. So we mentioned the lifeblood of the European economy is SMEs, family-owned, privately-owned businesses in Germany, Italy, Spain, and France, really the lifeblood and the backbone of the European economy. Now we're talking about moving from a bank-dominated funding model to a capital markets funding model. And guess what? SMEs don't naturally fund in the public capital markets. And so we have this discussion a lot about forming deeper and more liquid capital markets in Europe. We discuss a lot SMEs being the foundation of the European economy, and we're struggling with connecting the dots between those two things. And it's not easy, and I think there's potentially a couple of ways to connect the dots between SME funding and the capital markets. Some of them get discussed a lot, but haven't yet gotten any real traction. That can be technology. So peer-to-peer lending is getting a lot of press, getting some traction in certain jurisdictions, but the amount of peer-to-peer online lending is a drop in the bucket. You know, we've discussed private placement markets and mini bond platforms in places like Italy. Great ideas, but a mere drop in the bucket. And so I think to really connect the dots between SME funding and the public capital markets, the only way that I can think of doing that well is probably via the securitization route. So, you know, can you pool and package credit card debt, mortgage loans, student and university loans, other forms of housing finance, pool that, package it, sell it out into the capital markets? That's a way for the consumer or for smaller companies to potentially get access to the public capital markets. So much of getting Europe growing again hinges on SMEs. And if you're concerned, like I suggested earlier, about banks getting smaller and deleveraging, you know, how the SMEs fund themselves and their balance sheets going forward is a question for debate.
It's very encouraging, I think, to see Lord Hill, Jonathan Hill's approach of being much more pragmatic and recognizing that there has perhaps been too much regulation. Not all of it has always been as joined up as we would like. And that there are some obvious low-hanging fruit, some easy wins that we can start working on from the bottom up straight away, while at the same time also addressing or beginning to address some of these longer-term structural issues, such as, Philippe, you said the differences in insolvency law and differences in tax treatment and so on. And I think perhaps having the two coming together over time could be a very effective approach. I think one of the most encouraging things to come out of the Commission on Capital Markets Union so far, if you look at the Green Paper, it almost goes out of its way to explain in great detail that it wants the market to come up with its own solutions around Capital Markets Union. It says, I think, that it will only adopt regulatory solutions when the market fails to come up with its own version of what it wants and what might work, which is a huge change from his predecessor, and I think a very welcome one.
That's clear, it is encouraging, but on the other flip of the coin, you have a big problem, the fact that we have a few information about the SMEs. That is the key problem. At the moment, the banks know the small and mid-sized companies where they give them a credit, but regulators don't know them. We do not know them necessarily as much as the bank do. So we want to exclude the banks from a strategy to give the role to asset manager or to blah, 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 X, Y, Z. But nobody knows them precisely. And the regulators are pretty, pretty severe about these companies. Remember that European Banking Union Association, IMF, European Commission, Bank of England, ECB wants to alleviate the regulation. But if we don't know the paper which is in the securitization, then there's a spread of quality, liquidity, or risk, whatever. And if you don't know the asset, you don't invest in. So one of the major challenges we have for the coming years is of course to help the banks, to help to force the financial system to be more stable thanks to securitization, thanks to the access to financing, which is better in the coming years. But we have to modify some constraint, and particularly the absence of knowledge. Because what we know is that the capital markets union, which is working properly with the big companies, has some characteristic: transparency, liquidity, a number of players, etc., etc. And for the small and mid-sized companies, we don't have these guarantees yet.
Maybe to pick up that point and sort of perhaps go to a slightly higher level, I mean, the role ultimately of the financial system is to connect savers with borrowers. And I think the point you're making is, for small businesses, the banks have been traditionally the natural way of doing that. They have a monitoring role, they have a way of understanding the credit quality of those they're lending to and monitoring that through time. If we are to move to a more capital markets-based system in Europe, we need to ensure that that information there. So what type of information do you need? What type of structures, at a more practical level, do you think need to be seen in order to have prospectuses that would credit registers and so forth?
For the capital markets union, there are a lot of decisions which have to be taken internally, and taxation savings to favor long-term savings are probably the most important issues for the coming years if we want this capital market union to exist in practice for the small and mid-sized companies.
And Jim, do you sort of share this concern about the difficulty of mobilizing savings?
We don't worry about the absolute amount of savings in Europe, right? Europe's long savings, so there's no lack of liquidity available to SMEs. You know, I mentioned we're not connecting the dots well enough. It's of concern, so I share Philippe's point. I think there's something to be said about streamlining documentation. You know, even for very small businesses, is there a standardized accounting sheet that somebody could fill in that would lend itself to getting put into some sort of system, electronic platform that would allow us to aggregate SMEs and pool that into something that we can distribute to large institutional investors? I'm not just surprised, I'm shocked that technology is not yet playing a bigger part in the European capital markets, but by the way, the same is true in the US. And I say that both on the secondary market side, where a lot has been written recently in the press about lack of secondary market liquidity for corporate bonds. But if I were being damning of myself and my people, I'd say it about the primary markets as well. I think technology can and should play a much larger role in unlocking that pool of liquidity that's available in Europe. To do it well with SMEs, I think we do need more streamlined and standardized accounting standards, but very simple, low-touch disclosure, I think, would allow us to pool and ultimately securitize more SME loans potentially online. So I don't yet know why we can't advance that discussion, but if I'm a betting man, over the next 5 years around SME financing, I think technology will play a bigger role.
You've emphasized SME funding a lot. We've talked a lot about developing markets for both savers and investors. But infrastructure is another issue. So, I mean, that would seem to be something that has some of the characteristics of being a little bit more homogenous, maybe a little bit favoring longer-term investors.
This is an area that has historically been financed by commercial banks in Europe. Again, going back to my thesis, in the future, banks will be smaller. And how do you continue to ensure that vital infrastructure projects, whether they're roads, bridges, schools, and the like, continue to get built? An economy can't grow unless it has a robust infrastructure in place. A lot of infrastructure, and this is true globally, not just in Europe, you know, is really coming up to a place where it needs to get renewed, revitalized, and replaced. If the banks aren't providing that financing, again, something has to step into the void. The capital markets to date, not just in Europe, but even in the US, have not done a fantastic job around this. The capital markets should be able to efficiently finance infrastructure. They're desperate to put long-dated, yieldy assets into their portfolios. By definition, infrastructure is long-dated. It tends to be somewhat yieldy, but we haven't really done a very good job of connecting users of capital with the providers of capital around infrastructure. So I definitely think it's a part of the capital markets union discussion and a robust area to continue to debate.
Yeah, completely agree. And I think one of the challenges around that side of the debate is it again is going to put pressure back on policymakers to be more consistent and to provide more certainty from a policy perspective. One of the reasons the capital markets have struggled historically to get involved or to provide that sort of financing at the early stage is a lack of clarity, a lack of certainty about whether the rules of the game are about to change at short notice, depending on which government has been elected or rejected.
So as promised, let me ask each of you in turn, perhaps starting with William, so I'll give you a little more time to think about it. I mean, what would be the one initiative that you think is most important?
My top of my list, bigger pools of long-term capital. And perhaps the best way to do that would be to implement effective 20 years ago, but failing 20 years ago, effective tomorrow, compulsory contribution or auto-enrollment pension schemes in every country in Europe that doesn't currently have them. Yeah. The best time, it took the UK 30 years with its pension system to go from 20% of GDP to 100% of GDP. It would be great to have started 30 years ago in France and Germany and in Southern Europe. We haven't, but let's get cracking now.
Jim?
You asked for one, I'll give you two quick ones. I mentioned the one, which is I would allow the European retail investor to invest in a floating rate loan product. European investors can buy high yield bonds, but they can't buy high yield loans. That's just odd at best, and I think would unlock a big pool of capital for those medium sized, below investment grade rated companies that we all agree are critical to growing the economy. And then second, I would spend order of magnitude 90% of my time, if I were running this project as Lord Hill is, around this topic of SMEs. And so bigger companies I'm far less concerned about, small and medium-sized enterprises I'd be terrified about if I were a policymaker in a world where the banking system's gonna get smaller from here. And so this really very quickly becomes an SME discussion.
Philippe?
Governments do not have money anymore, so we don't have to trust them to help financially, I would say. So they can help with the laws, so securitization laws. It's probably important to have one law for all securitization. Bankruptcy laws is probably essential. TLAC, you know, the famous law for banks, is not done or nearly done, but for the companies, it has to be done. It's important because what happens at the end of the company, at the end of its life, will determine what happens during its life from an investor point of view. So we need to know exactly what happened at the end, if there's a problem, before investing. And the last but not least, you said one, I give four. It's data. We need data for the companies, because if you don't have data, it's very difficult to convince any risk department in the planet. They are powerful at the moment, which is good, but if you don't have any data, we cannot invest. So it's basic ideas to change the laws, change regulation, basic but not easy, because we have a lot of countries.
Let me thank the excellent panelists, William, Jim, and Philippe. And let me thank all of you for coming this afternoon. I have a feeling, as I said at the outset, this will be an ongoing dialogue. And if it's going to take until 2019 or beyond, we'll all be able to come back in our retirement and speak on these issues again. Thank you very much. Yeah.